Thank you for joining CACE International. I'm Fikisha Kumbo, and we're at the Louisiana Bar and Grill here in Manhattan with none other than Bernard Pretty Purdie. How you doing?
I'm doing wonderful.
That's good.
As they say, pretty good.
Tell us, how did you get the name Pretty Purdie?
Well, it happened by accident because many years ago, when I first came to New York, they couldn't pronounce my last name, so they were calling me Bernard Purdie. Okay, you know, they were trying to get it. As time went on, the Bernard got dropped, and the Purdie came Pretty Purdie, Purdie, Pretty Purdie. That's how they got my last name. So I've used it ever since. So it's always been Pretty Purdie. For about 15 years, people didn't know my first name. So I finally was able to get my first name back. I'm Bernard Pretty Purdie.
Okay. I thought it was because of the way you play those drums. That's the way I always thought it was.
Stop, yo. Well,
you know,
I try.
There was a time back, you know, 12, 15 years ago, that every other word was Bernard Pretty Purdie here and Bernard Pretty Purdie there. And then you kind of just like disappeared. Where have you been?
Well, actually, I never disappeared. I was recording, still recording a great deal. And I was actually on the road with different acts. At the time, I went out with rock and roll with Jeff Beck. And from Jeff Beck, I was still doing Aretha Franklin. So from there, I ended up going into the jazz field and being out with Dizzy Gillespie. I was out with Gato Barbieri for, I don't know, 6 or 7 years. And it really became jazz, Latin, funk, rhythm and blues, some, but then I got with Dizzy Gillespie, and it just became more and more jazz. They finally started to call me for jazz, because no one knew I played it.
So are you in the recording clique here in the city?
Well, I guess I am, because I'm still doing 3 or 4 dates a week.
Wow.
Yeah.
Studio.
Yeah.
What's that whole scene like?
It's completely different.
Which means what?
That most of the studio work today is being done by synthesizers and the electronic drums, the machines. And in the past 4 to 5 years, I have replaced the machines by overdubbing live drums.
Wow.
That's how good it's been.
Wow.
And I'm having a wonderful time with it.
So you're doing jingles and commercials and all that kind of thing. That's what the click people do, right?
That's what they do. I can't. I even did my first on-camera commercial.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, and I wasn't playing drums. I was singing.
Okay. I heard that.
I love it. I love it.
You know, your biographer say you're the smartest man in showbiz. What's he talking about?
Well, I got lucky. For a lot of years, I've listened to a lot of the older people in the business, because the biggest problem that we have is most of us as musicians are not very good business people. So in order to survive, I had to learn business. Once I started to learn the business, I started to really learn the industry. And if you utilize what you know, you can do anything you want. But you must be successful at it, or the business will bury you.
What does he mean when he say you? You know, the youth now use the word large, like he's really large, you know?
Well, for me, they're now using all the tracks that I played on for many, many years. And the kind of beat that they want was big beat. They wanted the James Brown, they wanted the Aretha Franklin, they wanted the Donny Hathaway, and they wanted all these different groups that were hit records at the time, but they wanted that beat. And to them, the term that they started using in order to do that, it had to be large. That was the terminology that's being used by the hip-hop. So when they found out, discovered that the drum beats that they've been taking from all these different records turn out to be one person, And they've been coming to me and telling me, oh, God, Purdie, you have just lost. Because it was you that we've been taking all these things from. Wow. Thank you. You know, I appreciate it.
So talk to me about subdividing the beats to improve the rhythm.
Subdividing is the easiest part. All you do is you take a rhythm, you take that same rhythm that you have, and each person that you give something to, you put them in the same category, the same space, and then you take it and cut it in half. Everybody now end up being in the same time, in the same space. So if you got four people, four different rhythms, four different things happening, you take that to equalize it. What I would do is play time, halftime against it. By playing halftime against that, I've now subdivided that same rhythm. And then you can also half that if you were able to count.
And if I'm able to follow you, what you you just lost
just
me completely.
Four quarter notes.
Yeah.
And then you end up having half of those four quarter notes, you end up with eight notes instead of
okay.
a half note.
And then 16ths.
And then 16ths.
And then 32s.
And then 32s.
Oh, okay,
you
I'm
do
smart.
All that.
I'm
You're
smart. You talked about making music make money. How do you do that?
Actually, it's really easy. Good music will always be around, no matter where you go, any place in the world. The only language in the world today is still music. It's a universal language. The people from the rest of the world want to play and actually want to hear melodies. You play melodies, you're going to work. People are going to buy your music. Now, if you're smart enough to have a groove with it and make it work so it's danceable or listenable, then you're going to make money. Because today, people want to dance. People want to feel good.
Yeah.
All over the world. And everywhere I go, the one thing that I do is that I'm going to give you a groove, I'm going to give you good time, and I'm going to make you feel good.
So it's a formula.
It's a formula. And it has worked for Motown, it has worked for Stax, it has worked for the Chicago Sound, it has worked for the Miami Machine, the LA Plastic City, as we call it. It's worked.
Does it work for hip-hop?
Yes, it has definitely worked for hip-hop, and that's why it's plentiful now. But for me, what I like, what I try to stick with, because I'm not trying to be 20 years, year old again, I like to give people melodies. So I'm going to play standards. I'm going to give them melodies that they know, that they think they know, or they can feel with a groove. And everything I do is going
to be
fun.
Your personalized videotapes that you've done now?
Well, I've been doing educational videos for a long time. I've done them since 1974. I was the first one to do drum videos and teaching. And with that, it evolved into doing and breaking down the structure of what drumming is like, what rhythms are like, what music is like. It's not just for drummers. My videos are not just for drummers. They're for musicians, people who want to be in the music field. So I have always tried to keep that idea in mind. Always keep it entertaining, but yet educational.
Well, you know, I understand that they're re-releasing some of your old prestige music. Well, tell me about that.